Hello and welcome to another episode of LedgerCast. I'm here again with Derek Walchek. Hey, Derek.
Hello.
How are you?
I'm great. How are you?
I'm doing well.
Good.
So I'm excited. We have another guest from a project in the crypto space. We have Paul Walsh from MetaCert and the MetaCert protocol. Hey, Paul.
Hey, how are you?
I'm doing great. Thanks for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah. We've got some sirens in the background over here to welcome your entrance. So you're welcome. You're
that's
welcome.
The first sign.
The podcast is here.
Yeah.
I don't know if that's a good sign or a bad sign. We'll take it as a good sign.
That's right.
So you're building the MetaCert protocol.
That's right. Well, the team is. And the I'm team. Trying to help.
All right.
Yeah, I want to start with a question. I absolutely love your signature blank on your email, Paul. I think it's just perfect because it really states what you want to create. And I'm going to read it, and then I'm going to have you sort of tell us more about it. CEO of MetaCert, Paul, I see a world where you feel safe when opening a link. Tell me about that.
That's it. It's something that everybody who uses the web worries about at some point in time. How do you know that bot or that application is not malware? How do you know the website is suitable for kids? How do you know it's not a phishing site? How do you know the verified badge on the Twitter account is real? Or, you know, how do you know it's not a fake Twitter account or a bot? And how do you know it's a safe API to open? So these are all questions that, you know, we ask ourselves every day. Some of those questions are more important to other people. So you may be passionate about blocking XXX content for yourself or your kids. You might be interested in avoiding fake news or misinformation. You may want just more information about the type of news that you're consuming. You know, is it far left? Is it far right? Is it satirical? Is it fake? Is it kind of centered? And basically, I would like to contribute to society in a way that helps you feel safer when opening a link. Does that make sense?
Yeah, absolutely. This is the type of thing that I'm accustomed to being from the web world. But I've become more hyper aware to it since I got into crypto, to the degree that I hardly trust anything unless I'm directly typing it in myself. And we've actually seen even recently, some really pretty advanced attack vectors. Are you familiar with the one that happened with Binance where they did a really sneaky phishing attack?
With the APIs.
And then they, so people would log in to what they thought was Binance. And this is not Binance's fault, but they logged into what they thought was Binance. But what was especially tricky was as soon as they got those login credentials, then they could never visit the website again. Like they then redirected them to the real thing. So you really only have to make the mistake and then you never know you made the mistake. And that was the scariest thing to me because I could click a link that someone shares on Twitter where I think I'm seeing the right URL and then it's just not, to the degree that yesterday, so Bittrex opened up a beta for their new interface and it was like beta .bittrex.com or something. And I didn't click the Twitter link because I was like, well, I need to see this in a, you know, for myself directly in the URL before I'm willing to trust it. So is this essentially the type of thing that y'all are trying to make safer for people to be able to trust?
That is one very specific problem that we're looking to address. And, you know, even experts fall victim. It's not people being stupid, as some people call them. Anybody can fall victim. There's been cases when I've seen my Ether wallet phishing sites and I've looked at it and I've spent considerable time looking at it and it looks legitimate. And then I've had to copy and paste it into a text file and increase it such that I could see tiny little dots underneath, you know, some of the letters. And so it's very difficult for anybody to, and you know what's even worse? I understand and I appreciate that companies in the crypto space have to use marketing campaigns in order to generate interest amongst people who are going to buy their tokens. And I understand that you have to have special offers and time-sensitive promotions. But you also need to be careful because if you get people accustomed to receiving an email or a Telegram message or a tweet saying, this special offer lasts 12 hours or 6 hours or 24 mm-hmm. hours, then they're going to get used to just clicking on that link really quickly without thinking about it. Whereas in the old days, you know, until 2017, when you got a traditional phishing scam inside an email, you kind of, everybody second guessed it. But when it comes to crypto, they don't second guess it. They just click on that link, open the website, log in quickly, try to get their special discount, and then they lose all their crypto assets. So what I would love to see, so what we've done is we've got a what's called a cyber threat intelligence system, which is basically a big database of the web categorized into about 60 categories, you know, sports, religion, news, media. Phishing is one of those categories. And what we do is we take a feed from many different sources that provide those lists, and we put them into one machine-readable format. But then we also have people in the crypto world reporting links to us directly. We have a way to identify links ourselves across all of the communities that we're installed in. And then we have experts inside our own Slack group reporting directly to us, specifically crypto phishing websites. And these are people who work for some of the biggest security companies in the world, reporting them directly to us. So that's all gone into one database. And so we built a number of products that help protect you from those links. And one product, which is free, is a browser extension called Kryptonite. But it does two things. One, it blocks those phishing sites, as well as the fake Twitter accounts and other fake social media accounts, because we're the only company in the world that can currently classify different parts of a folder or different parts of a string. But the other thing that Kryptonite does is it, when you land on a legitimate crypto exchange or a wallet, it changes a shield on the toolbar, our shield, from black to green. And the reason for that, and this really scares me, the reason for that is that everybody is looking for the green shield, the padlock, the green padlock. But that means absolutely nothing. In fact, please do not ever look for the green padlock, because that is a basic SSL certificate and it does one thing. It encrypts the transmission of your data from your browser to the website to make sure nobody can hack it. So when you're typing in your username and password and wallet address, you know it's safe if you see HTTPS. Mm-hmm. But you don't know, well, sorry, you know it's secure. But you don't know if it's safe because you don't know if the website you're typing those details into really is the company you think it is. Mm-hmm. Because in order for that to happen, you need, that company needs to prove to what's called a certificate authority, cybersecurity mm-hmm. company like Komodo.
An extended validation certificate.
An extended validation certificate. But you know what that does? That extends the green from the padlock to the company name. And less than 0.1% of the world actually knows that. Even technical people, most technical people don't look for it. They don't even understand it. And so the verification process can always be tricked as well. But so I would love the exchanges and wallets to promote Kryptonite amongst their communities so that we can verify their website and all of their social media accounts. So when you land on a specific tweet, the shield goes from black to green. When you land on a specific Facebook page or you go to their GitHub account or you go to their website, the shield is green. And if it's black, don't go there until you can prove otherwise. And we've seen people now on Twitter say, I'm not logging into this website until I see the shield turn green. And then we also have go on, sorry.
No, finish your thought there.
That the last bit is, and now we're seeing exchanges and wallets coming to us asking to be verified because their community is saying, we're nervous. Our community is nervous. They want to see the green shield.
Just as a brief aside, this isn't, I don't think personally, to belittle the importance of getting SSL across the web, which has been a huge, huge agenda item for Let's Encrypt and others. But Let's Encrypt has really driven this to where adoption of SSL and then, you know, Chrome and Brave and others forcing SSL on every website. That's been a big deal and that's good. But there's an education gap is what you're saying, that just having an SSL certificate doesn't make a website safe. It just makes it encrypted. So you're saying...
Most cybersecurity professionals that you hear talk about that very thing will say it's great. But actually, no, it's not great by itself. Yes, of course, we need to encrypt as many websites as possible to protect people. However, you brought up Let's Encrypt. Mm-hmm. Would it surprise you to hear that Let's Encrypt has sold, or sorry, not sold, they have issued over 20,000 SSL certificates to domains with the term PayPal in it?
No, I'm certain that they have done all sorts of stuff like that, because they're just a...
Crazy.
But they're just an API, basically, that's
I totally agree.
Issuing SSL.
Some people say, well, that's all they should do. Well, I'm sorry, that's not true. If you expect Facebook to address fake news, and we expect Twitter to address bullying and abuse and racism, and we expect other platforms to implement some kind of social responsibility, I don't see why Let's Encrypt should be any different. I'm not saying they're responsible for phishing. I'm not saying they should address phishing on the web. However, by doing nothing at all, I think that's irresponsible personally. I don't think that's good enough. They should try.
That's certainly an interesting argument that kind of yes. comes from the other
As you
side.
Can see,
of the,
I'm a bit passionate about it.
Yeah, this comes from the other side of the spectrum for me, because I come from a world where as a web developer, I've tried to encourage people to use SSL for years, but I'd certainly see the education gap, because we've taught people, well, you can buy something from an e-commerce website, or you can log into a site as long as there's an SSL certificate, right. Not this extra layer. So can we back up a step and just get the high level more broadly of what MetaCert is doing, what you do.
Before we do that,
okay,
yeah. I can't get over the My Ether wallet that you mentioned and how you needed to actually put it into a text file, and then you saw words or letters with periods underneath them. I guess they're like...
It's a special...
Greek words or...
Special characters, and a domain registrar will let you register.
So here's my question, apart from the SSL stuff. How many MyEther phishing sites would you say there are in the world right now that are not real?
I could count them right now, and it would probably represent the vast majority of them. I would say many hundreds.
That's amazing.
Which is why many, many hundreds, which is why when I attended a conference yesterday, I gave a talk on cybersecurity and crypto, and I then attended another panel where there was people from token companies talking, and they advise people to buy a few domains to make sure they can't be phished. Number one, it's okay to buy a couple of domains, but actually it doesn't do a whole lot. But what I also wouldn't do is redirect those additional domains to your main domain, because you also don't want your users, your visitors to get used to being redirected. So you have to be very careful.
All right, so there's hundreds of fake MyEther wallet addresses. Let me ask you this, is just one, and we can get on to the subject of this, but I'm curious personally. So if I use a Trezor wallet, okay, and I'm on a fake one, okay, and I connect my wallet to the fake MyEther wallet site, can they also take my money using that, or would they only be able to take my money if I filled in my private key onto the fake?
If you fill in your private key.
Yeah.
So I'm still safe if I use Trezor or a hardware wallet with a fake. Okay, good.
Yeah, if you're using a hardware wallet right here, then...
Give me that.
Here, you don't have the pen.
Yeah.
That's what you think.
So if you're using the hardware wallet, then your information, everything is on the hardware wallet. So, and that's one of the marketing things that they put. Yeah. I think maybe Ledger does actually puts that on their stuff, is that you're still safe even if you're somewhere that's not. The difference is a lot of people, I'd say the vast majority of people, probably go to MyEther wallet or a phishing site, and that's where they create the wallet. So essentially they're allowing the web domain to host the wallet, and that's when you become unsafe.
Makes sense. All right, so MetaCert.
So MetaCert is a security company. As I mentioned, has that cyber threat intelligence system, because not every security company has that. The companies that don't have it license the data from companies like MetaCert or other security companies that do have it. And our security products are focused primarily on messaging platforms such as Slack, HipChat, Skype, Messenger, because we predicted a few years ago that phishing would migrate from email to messaging platforms. And lo and behold, it has. In 2017, we saw an uptake in phishing scams throughout Slack communities in the crypto world. And that's what MetaCert does. It builds security products. It has browser extensions to protect kids and schools and families from XXX content. We have anti-phishing add-ons. We have extensions for news reputation. It annotates the web. And then we have an API. We have an API that's used by thousands of applications to help block that kind of content, to help block phishing. Now, MetaCert Protocol is a new entity. It's a different entity. And what we're doing is we're getting that entire cyber threat intelligence system and putting it onto the blockchain. And then decentralizing trust and reputation. So remember when I talked about verifying websites and social media accounts? Well, that is just quite not, that's not scalable for one entity like MetaCert or even VeriSign or Symantec. So by putting it on the blockchain, by creating a registry, well, we're just calling it a registry. It's what we have already. There's over 10 billion URIs. But by introducing a tokenized economy, we can, for the first time, decentralize trust and reputation. Because up until now, it just really hasn't worked. You couldn't prove to me that the website you've submitted is really a phishing site or is not a phishing site, because there's no way to know what kind of reputation score that you have and the likelihood of you submitting good or bad quality URLs. So by incentivizing with a token, by putting a stake in, then you're less likely to try and disrupt the data, because you'll want to improve the quality of the data for a number of reasons. One, you've staked some token, and two, by improving the quality of the registry, then you increase the value of the entire network, because the bigger that registry is and the better quality that registry is, the more likely it will be adopted by big companies like Belkin, Linksys, Yahoo, Microsoft, for improving security inside of their hardware devices and their software. So imagine a world where all public Wi-Fi is used the new MetaCert protocol, so that every time you went to open a link, you checked the protocol real quick to see if it's safe or not. And if it's not safe, block it. And if it is safe, permit access. Because it does all of that currently in less than 150 milliseconds.
I have a couple of baby steps questions. I'm familiar with the way centralized entities handle comment spam. So in my world, Akismet is like this big comment spam engine. It's very smart, but it's centralized. It's owned by the company that owns WordPress.com, and they have tons of data. I'm also familiar with the way web application firewalls work, or a WAF, and there are companies that block malware and stuff like that for their clients and the websites that run that software. And they're very smart, but that's central data that then each of these may share it with other companies, like you mentioned. So one question is, what's required on the behalf of the user for using MetaCert when you're trusting a link? Because on these, the website has to install the software that's protecting it or protecting its users. So I don't know what's required on the behalf of the user. And then second is, the way this industry works now very similar, where it's centralized information sharing or collection and then sharing? And that's what you're decentralizing?
Well, first of all, the end user, when using a product like Kryptonite or our Slack security app or our security bot for Telegram, the user doesn't have to do anything. So if you take the Telegram bot, for example, the group administrator installs it in less than 5 seconds, and then it listens in the background quietly, and the user doesn't have to do anything.
The administrator, though, is using it. Or they're the ones responsible for installing it.
Yeah, or it could be Belkin or Linksys that just installed some parsing code inside their home wireless routers to quickly check the MetaCert protocol before allowing a user to open up a website in their home. So it would always be the hardware provider or the software application. It could be the browser vendor. It could be Chrome, Firefox, or Brave that would look to the protocol instead of looking to their certificate authority for the SSL certificate information or anti-phishing.
So basically any entity, from hardware to software application at the lowest level, can be responsible for essentially helping the user validate a link or detect bad links ahead of time. And any of them could be your customer or a user of the MetaCert protocol in the land of decentralized services.
Absolutely. In fact, we're in talks with a security company right now, and they specialize in blockchain-related security and wallet addresses. So they're looking at the possibility of looking at using our protocol to determine whether or not a wallet address has a reputation, or if it's known to be a malicious wallet address. So anything at the end of a URI is what we're particularly good at classifying. It could be a wallet address, a bot, an application, or a website. And so to answer your second question, all of the cybersecurity companies are centralized, but a lot of them share those lists. And when you look at pornography, for example, look at any filter in the world, excluding MetaCert, they will not block enough websites, and they will block too many websites. So their error rate of false positives is between 10 and 15%. And they do not technically have the ability to classify content on websites with user-generated content. So they cannot classify folders on Dailymotion or Twitter or Facebook without classifying the entire domain. We can. And then the second thing is our error rate of false positive in that regard is 0.3%. Wow. When it comes to something like phishing, there are about 10 decent open source lists. One of them is called PhishTank, owned by OpenDNS, which was acquired by Cisco. And it's a good list. And companies will typically use one of those lists in order to be able to provide anti-phishing. And sometimes it will catch links that the Google Safe Browser API does not catch. And sometimes Google Safe Browser API will catch links that they don't catch. Whereas what MetaCert does is it aggregates all of that data and puts it in with our own data. So you have one central source, which is decentralized effectively, because what we're going to do is allow anybody to submit and validate links. And we attribute a reputation score to each individual based on historical information and other data points. So we can identify people who are particularly good. You might be particularly good and interested at classifying websites as sports. And if you've classified 100 websites and it's 100% accuracy because everybody agrees with you, then your reputation score is increased and maybe we need fewer people to validate your submissions in the future. So that's the gamification. The reward of the token is what then also incentivizes you. Mm-hmm. So in regards to phishing, what I would love to see all of the participants who contribute to those open source lists come and contribute to our list instead, because there's a greater chance of us reducing the risk of bad actors spoiling the data, which they cannot do, and they'll get rewarded. Because if you contribute to other open source lists, you don't get rewarded other than the fact that you know you're adding value to society, which, you know, is great. And for a lot of people, that's good enough.
Who are the people currently taking time out of their day to report these things without a reward?
It varies from... Actually, you'll find a lot of companies who are customers of the data will submit links because they've seen them come in through, let's say it's an email company. They will typically use an open source anti-phishing list to protect their users from phishing. But by doing it, so they don't have the ability to look up more than one list, mostly because it adds too much time to the call. But when we aggregate it all and put it on a one registry, and there's a response time of 150, 160 milliseconds after checking over 10 billion URIs, then it makes more sense to come to our registry. So, and so they're just two... Go on, sorry.
I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No, so that's just two types. So think of our registry as a Whois database or an IMDb for the web, where you can find out different types of information about the same resource, about the same website or Twitter account. The one website you could have, imdb.com, is classified as movies or entertainment, but Fast and Furious would be classified as movies, entertainment, and automotive. And so by being able to have that granular classification system, which we've been building over the years, it means that an ad network or a brand could look to our protocol to, first of all, exclude placing ads on fake news and undesirable websites that they would like to avoid with a great degree of accuracy, while at the same time pointing their ads at very specific category websites. Now, that kind of use case doesn't really get us out of bed at MetaCert, but it's one use case that we don't particularly work on, but somebody else could build a solution on top of our protocol to answer that problem. And so if you think of our registry as basically the entire web classified into, currently it's about 60, 65 categories, but we see a world where the market will determine what that tagging system would look like in the future. You know, the IMDb has a very structured way of categorizing the web, but it's very old and outdated. And so, you know, you'll never see a drop down menu.
How are the rules managed in a scenario like this? So do people have to trust you to essentially be the governance mechanism on what's okay and what's not okay for the web? Or is there something more granular than that? Because it still seems like maybe it reminds me of ad blockers, you know, like where the ad blocker maybe blocks all the bad guys, except for they sell rights for people to still show ads to some people, you know, that you still have the middleman. Are you still a middleman, or how do you take yourself out of the equation?
Well, first of all, MetaCert doesn't actually say whether something is good or bad or indifferent. What the protocol does is it tells you more information about the resource, and then you determine, because you may want to actually look for and find pornography. You don't necessarily want to block it. So we just tell you a particular domain or URI is XXX or far left or far right, and you may want to look for and consume that kind of content. So we don't say what's good or bad. We have no opinion. We're completely unbiased. But then to go back to your first question, MetaCert is currently a centralized cybersecurity company. We are the ones that are verifying crypto websites, but I don't want that anymore for a number of reasons. One, we can't possibly scale that. We want society to contribute. And two, we would like to decentralize trust and reputation. And that actually means removing MetaCert and other cybersecurity companies from the equation of trust. So when you look to the MetaCert protocol, it's actually called MetaCert protocol, but we're really just facilitating you to actually do all of the submission and validation work. And so if something has been classified, anybody can dispute it at any time. So you'll have that open and transparent ledger of every resource on the web, and you'll be able to see who submitted it, who validated it, who disputed it, when did that take place, what was the previous classification,
right,
what was the metadata used at that point in time, what did the screenshot of the website or bot look like at that particular point in time. And so MetaCert is really just facilitating that. And so we're actually going to be giving away a lot of tokens to a number of different strategic partners who want to adopt the protocol and the token itself to incentivize its own economy.
So you're building a token curated list, essentially.
There is a nice term bandied about called a token curated registry. You could call it that, because that's exactly what it is. The difference being, when people want to create a token curated registry, they do it in order to accelerate the growth of the network effect. We just happen to already have over 10 billion URIs to start with. We have about 1 million unique domains not yet classified that we can just have on a web page for you to categorize. And we have a few hundred thousand people using different products. And probably, I would say...
Yeah, I didn't mean that to diminish what you're doing at all.
No, not at all. You didn't for a second.
I was setting up a question.
Some people think a token curated registry is fantastic. And some people think, oh, that's another buzz term to add. So I'm trying to play it in the middle and say, look,
that's fair.
We have this registry. We have a database on the blockchain. You can call it a TCR, we'll be happy with that.
One of the critical things for you to get right is the tokenomics, or the way that the tokens work. Because, you know, if Ledger sets up a website and I have a competing website and I call it pornography, and it's worth it to me to lose whatever coins I'm going to lose to burn him, I'm going to make more money by burning him. It's going to be important to get the economics right of the token. So can you speak to how you'll set up your system and what that looks like?
Well, at least we have a lot of experience with the human behavior. So if you could imagine a world where we have a lot of people using a safe iPad browser and a Firefox extension, a Chrome extension, and a DNS service for the purpose of blocking XXX content, either in schools or at home. Some people do it for themselves, and some people do it for the people for whom they're responsible, their kids. And when you get blocked from a website, you get a block page, and it actually gives you the opportunity to dispute it in case it's a false positive. Because then when a false positive is submitted, we evaluate it and check the keywords and check all of the algorithms to make sure that we can fine-tune the system to reduce the likelihood of that happening in the future. But what we found was a lot of kids would constantly dispute the same websites over and over. So I said to the engineers, look at... like youporn.com. And it's like, dude, chief engineer, you guys don't want to be reviewing this stuff. Right. Just can we do something to stop this? So we introduced some business logic so that the first time a website was disputed and reviewed by a human, and it was thought that it was done through malicious intent, it was then locked. So when you try to dispute it again, it would give you a message to say, thank you very much, but this has already been validated by a human a second time. And if you still think this is an issue, please open a ticket. So you're kind of making it a little bit more difficult, but still possible for them to continue along the process of disputing a link. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, we're used to that. The technology has a lot of that stuff built in. Of course, we're building new technology with smart contracts and stuff. So, but we're used to the human behavior. And I think when it comes to the 60 categories of news, media, entertainment is pretty simple. Phishing is pretty simple. I would say verification, a little bit more tricky, but you know, there's numerous data points. There's numerous, we have to start off a little bit slowly. So let's say you submit 10 websites and you want to evaluate 50 websites. Then the ones that you evaluate in your dashboard are actually randomly put there. This, everybody does not get to see the same type of information to validate, because that way you could also work with a friend and say, hey, I'm going to submit this website. I want you to validate it. And you could do that tenfold. So actually,
by decentralizing this whole process and putting it on the blockchain, are you at all opening yourself up to new attack vectors, because you're essentially making what was proprietary methods public?
I would say the opposite. There will be some proprietary elements to it for the purpose of security. But I would actually say we're doing the opposite, because we're already a single point of failure. We're already a target for social engineering and hacking. And, you know, our servers are constantly being hit by actually decentralizing it. And eventually, when it's possible, decentralizing the actual data, the queryable database, when that's decentralized, then it'll be even more safe. So we want to remove MetaCert and other security companies and reputation systems from the equation and have it as decentralized as possible, so that we're not the single point of failure. You know,
The reason I ask is it's making me think of SEO a little bit, in the sense of, you know, it's this black box of how Google decides something is a good or a bad website. Yeah. And that's not quite the same as a link, but it's a similar algorithm that you're using, because Google theoretically is trying to say this is a trustable website and should show up in search results. And their argument has historically been, well, we don't want people to know that formula, because if you know the formula, you can game it to get around it. And I'm curious if you think that is a risk profile for a public version of what MetaCert does.
I don't think so. I think there are very few elements that we have to be concerned about that could compromise the system. Remember, actually, we would also like other companies. MetaCert is one customer of MetaCert protocol. We would like to see other companies also becoming nodes of the protocol and then adding to that additional information that they see fit. And so we don't see MetaCert protocol as being the only source of that information. We would like other companies to take a copy of that and extend it and improve it. We will do things like, for example, what does the green shield in Kryptonite mean? What does being verified mean? We don't want to copy and paste old problems and solutions to the blockchain. So like these AirPods, Apple thought to themselves, you know, if we were to invent headphones today, what would we do? We don't want to improve those crappy wire things. What would we do if we were to invent them for the first time today? So that's what we're doing with Verified. What does it actually mean to people today? And so part of the decision-making process is opening it up to the community. So the team and I had a conversation last night with our administrators and said, okay, what do you guys think it means? And we need to open this up. We want the community to get involved in the decision-making process of what it means to have something verified. In the same way that news reputation is going to be one of the most difficult things to get right. Mm-hmm. I don't pretend to get that right in day one.
Publicly scrutinized items because it's extremely hard. It's not like Facebook is welcoming the criticism that they're receiving right now. I'm sure they have hundreds of people working on this to try to figure it out.
If Facebook didn't exist, we wouldn't be having this conversation, quite frankly, in my opinion.
You're throwing out there.
All right.
Boom.
So,
I met somebody at Facebook who said, I don't think fake news is a problem.
Interesting. So obviously you're in a phase now where you're getting close to introducing tokens into the system. Can you speak to what the next few months will look like as far as, a public sale, a private sale, who's working on it? How's it going to roll out, et cetera?
The building of the smart contract and some of the reputation system will probably be ready in about 3 weeks on a testnet. Before the white paper is published. So I don't know if that's because we're really fast at building tech or if we're just really slow at writing documents.
Yeah.
So the white paper, the terms of sale, the technical specification, and the token design document are all pretty much done. We're just waiting for legal opinion to say, yes, we believe this is a true utility token because without it, these services would not exist. These people would not be able to turn on this functionality and you would not be able to open up your database to the public to decide what is trustworthy or not. So
why do y'all need to raise money in the first place?
Say that again, please.
Why do y'all need to raise money in the first place to launch the network?
Because we're going to run out of money soon and we have to be able to sustain the business and grow the company. To be able to hire a CTO, director of marketing, director of sales.
For the purposes of the network, not for the purposes of your corporation.
So we have a number of partnerships in the line already. For example, Rocket Chat is an extraordinarily close partner of ours. And they and us are going to build an open source module for Rocket Chat so that if you're a customer using Rocket Chat as an alternative to Slack, then you will have a one-button option to implement anti-phishing. And they will adopt our meta token. If it's called a meta token, that's the kind of working name right now. So they will use a token in order to incentivize and reward people in their network for reporting and validating links within the registry, within the protocol. So that partnership is absolutely happening. And we need to be able to facilitate that. We need to be able to develop that stuff. We have to be able to maintain the open source code and it's the usual stuff.
And what is the goal in terms of raising funds?
So we're hoping to raise, we're aiming for $40 million. And there will be a private sale. But actually what we're more interested in is getting people so people are registering for participation in the network. The inbound interest has been insane because anybody who's got in touch to say, I really want to participate, they're doing so because they've actually come from one of our products or they've heard about us because a friend has used one of our products or they're in a community on Slack that's protected by our software. And so they really get the value and they really want to participate and they really want to make the web a safer place. So there is a private sale, but that is primarily to allow people a bigger allocation. There is no discount. There is no bonus. Everybody is treated equal. It's just for the purpose of being able to get that bigger allocation. And then the public sale will happen sometime after that. People don't have to worry about not being able to participate. Our goal is to get real participation from people who contribute to society by making the web a safer place for everybody. Because I would like to make sure that no matter where you are in the world, if you have access to a basic computer or smartphone, We will provide a website and a simple application for you to participate in wherever you are in the world. And if it's possible, I'd love to be able to give some people that basic equipment to be able to participate in the network and then get rewarded for it in tokens. We're working in partnership. We're supported by Consensus. And so they're particularly good and they're very experienced at the token economics and the design of the token and that interaction. So they've been extraordinarily helpful in that regard. Also, we're part of their collective group. It's a small group who are abiding by best practices under what's called the Brooklyn Project. And so, you know, our token will be available before they're sold or shortly after they're sold. The team, actually, what we want to do is to make sure that we demonstrate longevity of the project and our commitment. So 75% of our own tokens will be locked up and vested monthly over a three-year period. This is a long-term project, a three-year period. Okay. Yes.
How does that relate to a lot of the projects that you've seen out there and compared you to?
Some projects do similar things, and they're the projects that I admire and I like. Some projects, you'll find that the founding team has taken a bigger chunk of tokens, and then they've got liquidity, and then once they have liquidity, they kind of sometimes they give up and they sell it. And some people think that that's okay. They're going to be motivated. That I'm not sure that's entirely true. It's like stock options pool, right? You need to be able to vest it over time. And we don't want anybody just selling large amounts of token. And we don't want necessarily people holding on to large amounts of token. We need them being used and to unlock software, to use products. And it's not just inside the MetaCert network. Like, for example, with Kryptonite, when we start charging for it, a small fee in, say, a year's time. So every user of Kryptonite right now will get about 360 tokens, and they will be unlocked as soon as the smart contract is developed, and it'll happen inside the extension. And so after about a year, when we start to charge for that software, you can either pay for it with tokens. When you pay for it in tokens, you're actually able to offset the cost because over the year, you'll have submitted a few websites or information about websites, or you'll have validated websites, and you'll end up making more token than
the number
of tokens you spend. Exactly. Right. And we have that across all of our products, but we also have partnerships with a number of different organizations that want to adopt the protocol and the token, not just the protocol. Some companies will only want the protocol, but some would like the token as well as the protocol to incentivize a kind of behavior within their own network, their own community.
And in the end of the day, is MetaCert going to be its own blockchain, or is this going to run on the Ethereum virtual machine? What's that going to look like?
Yeah, we're working on the Ethereum blockchain. And our goal is to also decentralize the queryable database. Right now, that's not possible. You'll never find a curated registry that is queryable on the blockchain because it would take such a long time to get a response. When it comes to anti-phishing, you want to know about it within real time or at least within a minute. So we're talking to and keeping an eye on companies like OceanDB. Ocean Protocol, because it's yep. also kind of partnered with Protocol BigchainDB. So Ocean Protocol, they're working on building, and they'll probably kill me for paraphrasing them badly, but part of what they want to do is to build a decentralized version of MongoDB. So we don't want to have to build that by ourselves. So it'd be great to work with a company like that and make sure that, you know, their roadmap includes some of the stuff that we need.
And if you could leave listeners and viewers with kind of parting words, what would it be?
Do not use your phone number as a password backup and recovery, because people can use what's called social engineering to convince your cell network provider to give them a new SIM card. And once they have your number, they can do a password reset on Gmail and MailChimp and so on. And that's how a lot of people in the crypto world get attacked, especially teams that run cryptocurrencies. When they have access to MailChimp, then they email everybody and say, come to this website and give me all your crypto assets. I would also advise everybody to install Kryptonite, because you're extremely unlikely to fall for a phishing scam if you have Kryptonite. It's free. install our Telegram bot. That's free for community owners. It's also free for individuals who just want to send a link to the bot and say, is this safe or not? It'll say yes or no. And go to our Telegram group, t.me/MetaCert, and get involved in the project.
That's great. Paul, you've got a lot of passion, and I love it. You clearly are excited about what you're doing, and so I wish you a lot of luck.
Thank you so much. I appreciate it.
Thanks for joining us, and we will catch y'all next time. So, Derek, we just got off the call with Paul Walsh, and he had a lot to say.
He did.
We had a lot to learn. I admitted walking into that one having no idea really what MetaCert was or what they planned to do. I don't know, but part of that clicked with me. What about you?
Yeah, I think I mentioned it, but I think Paul's got a ton of passion. He's definitely got a vision for where he wants to take it. I think you know, the ability to sort of crowdsource information like this is sort of a new tool for him to really implement his vision.
Mm-hmm.
I think he's really excited about that, and he can see how these new tools can be used to do what he'd like to see in the world.
I can definitely see the value of what they're trying to provide. I've never really thought of it in terms of link integrity and trying to tell people, hey, this is a good website or a bad website. I think in the age of where there is so much activity in chat and apps, and it's just a little different than what I'm used to, but I am comfortable with this idea of, you know, security and verifying the quality of something. Like I mentioned in the call, both comments and then like web application firewalls with malware and stuff like that. And this is like another leg of that same thing to me.
Mm-hmm.
And I've heard from people in that industry about the value of sharing data and information, and they essentially sell, it's like almost like a marketplace for data, because, you know, you run a million websites and you have so much data and information based on these attack vectors and how to prevent it and protect people. So bringing that to an open ledger makes sense to me, that I connected with that.
Mm-hmm.
What did you think in terms of the token dynamics and that kind of stuff? Because they're looking to raise $40 million, he said.
Yeah, that sounds kind of high given the state of the market at the moment. But I know that there's so much buzz about them and what they're trying to do. They've hired Consensus to build.
What is Consensus?
Their smart contract. They're some of the best at basically creating your tokenomics, building the smart contracts, and knowing how the thing should look and be structured.
So Consensus, are they good at like helping people that don't have as much experience on the blockchain side of things bring it to the blockchain? Is that basically?
Yeah, it's kind of like, why develop a bunch of new skill sets that, you know, take you time to learn? Just outsource that function. Okay.
So does this allow a company that doesn't have a lot of people that are blockchain professionals still build an effective blockchain?
Well, they're not rebuilding a blockchain. They're going to go on the Ethereum.
Sure, but you're network. Still building functionality in your functionality. Smart contract that, you know, you're still writing code that's relevant to the ecosystem,
right,
even if you're not creating a whole brand new blockchain.
Yeah, and I'm sure there's others besides Consensus. It's just Consensus is the one that I've heard other folks use.
Yeah, and I didn't really know too much about it, but that's good to hear. The $40 million, I guess they do have the lockup of mm-hmm. 3 years, so that you're looking at what, $12-13 million a year that is runway for them to get a network launched. And that seems about right to me in terms of what I would want to see a lockup as, because it takes
they're going to raise 40 and I'm not sure what percentage of the tokens are going to be, you know, in people's hands. Not the company's not going to have the whole thing.
Yeah.
But no, I think they're doing it right.
Yeah. And I missed the math on that goes to them, but let's say they keep 30%.
Right.
Then it's even smaller of a runway. That's,
you know, here's a mental image and I can't get out of my head, so I'm going to go ahead and say it here. Sure. It's interesting thinking about all the new, like if you think about it in the natural world, I have a bunch of chestnut trees.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. I have a farm and there's a thing called the chestnut gall wasp.
Okay.
That has never been in the United States before. And some sort of wood came over with the gall wasp and it started attacking chestnut trees in the Southeast. And every year it's been spreading. And so now it's all the way to Michigan. And I think it's taken maybe 20 years to get all the way up there. And what happens is your trees basically don't produce. But after a year or two, the thing that eats the chestnut gall wasp finally makes it to where the chestnut gall wasp is. And then you have a natural predator that comes in. And it's interesting thinking about all these phishing and malware and just how there's all these new places for them to go. Like they were talking about, mm-hmm. you know, being first in Slack. then they've migrated to Telegram, and then obviously heading probably to
Discord.
Discord, and how, you know, the natural predator is just keeping up with the bad actors in the space. And it's, again, it's just mimicking the real world.
Yeah, and you always have that back and forth with software and security, where, you know, the bad guys figure out an attack vector and the good guys covered up.
Mm-hmm.
And you just keep doing that dance.
It's a constant battle.
So that's why I certainly see there being network value here. Whereas a lot of times I wonder, like, does this need mm-hmm. the blockchain? While this industry has worked well for a long time, centralized and saying, here's our data, give me your data.
Has it worked well?
Sure, it works. You know, the security industry from a web perspective is pretty advanced, I think. But it doesn't mean it's the right way to do it.
Right.
And I think this, what interests me here is that this is offering a compelling use case.
Mm-hmm.
I still always have this slight uncertainty about a company that has a historical run as a private company saying, here's our open network.
Mm-hmm.
Partially because, how do you convince other people that have private interests in this realm, like say their competitor, to say, oh yeah, we're just going to go hop on MetaCert's network.
Right.
Because it still says MetaCert, you know what I mean? And I don't really know how much that side of the politics, you know, mm-hmm. exists in this industry. It's just what I wonder about when I think of something like this. So
maybe, I think if they can get the big network that they're trying to build, then you'll almost be forced to use it at some point.
Yeah, I mean, if you create a commanding product, then essentially people end up building on your ecosystem. And he talked about a little bit, towards the latter part of the call about open source and the way he envisions open source. And I think that's good insights to have too, to where I trust a little bit more, like, of what their incentives are and why them understanding the nature of open source.
Because mm-hmm.
a lot of people do get into this space and they don't really know anything about open source. They just know you can raise a lot of money on a blockchain related entity. Yeah, so I thought that was good. Overall, I felt like this would be the type of project I'd be willing to take a risk on.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they're not done raising money, and I'm not involved in this. You're not mm-mm. currently involved in this, yeah. but
I'd like to be.
So your score would be?
I think it makes a lot of sense. And I like projects that come into the crypto world that are not, that don't really fit into a box. You know, they're not like just the same thing. You know, we're going to build a blockchain and it's going to do this. It's going to do this faster or whatever. Mm-hmm. This is a different project that's kind of using the tools of crypto in a different way. And I think those kind of projects are the ones that are going to succeed, where they're just kind of coming out of left field and you're like, oh, I didn't even think that we could kind of mix these things up and use it like this.
Yeah. And I have no idea how that plays out from a speculative sense and whether there will be speculative value in the short term you can bring to something like that.
I think they're trying to really, first of all, what he said was, in the private sale, there will be no discounts whatsoever. Mm-hmm. So if you buy it in the private sale or you buy it in the public sale,
if you're looking for the flip,
you're going to be paying the same thing.
Yeah.
So I think they really are trying to keep speculation to the degree they can out of the game.
Yeah. So maybe not good for, like, if you're looking for some short term quick flip. But if you've got a portion of your portfolio where you're saying, hey, I'm going to let this ride on
mm-hmm.
some companies to give it a shot for a longer term, then maybe this could be the type of thing that does well. So yeah. I'd be interested from that perspective.
Okay.
All right. We'll catch y'all next time. Have a good day.
Monuments crumble in the blink of an eye. River has just run dry.